Welcome to the latest edition of Access All Areas Backstage Podcast. Today I'm delighted to have Harvey Goldsmith here on stage, a promoter, one of the best known in the country, if not the world, and the events he's staged, particularly Live Aid, is obviously probably the best known concert that's ever taken place. It's difficult to know where to start this interview, Harvey, because you've had such a long and impressive career, but obviously Live Aid took place in 1985. The following year, I was a young man at Wembley Stadium amongst the debris following a Queen gig and looked up at that stage and saw you standing there at the end of the gig and thought, that's the job I'd love. That's the business I want to get into. If I'm not going to do that job, I want to get involved in events in some way. What was your moment? What was your moment that kind of encouraged you to get into the business? Because you were a pharmacy student in Brighton, if I remember rightly.
I was. I went to the College of Technology, yes, a whole new world, in Brighton to study pharmacy. And 6 weeks after I'd arrived, because I wanted to do a particular course on applied pharmacy, my interest was actually perfumery and cosmetics and how they were made and marketed. And 6 weeks after the course started, I discovered or was told that the grants hadn't come through and the course was cancelled for the year, which was brilliant. So I got very pissed off about it. And in pharmacy, it's a very intense three-year university course, and then you have to do a year's apprenticeship. So all medical courses are 4 years. But we worked in pharmacy school 6 days a week. So here we're at this brand new university, which is all about, you know, one tutorial and a couple of lectures a week, and the pharmacy department's working 6 days a week. So nobody ever saw them. I turn up a student union meeting. I'm listening to all the president of the union going through the chess club, the bridge club, the rugby football, blah, 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 blah. And I said, where's the social life? And the president kind of said, who the hell are you? And I said, I'm from pharmacy. And everybody looked around and said, we'd never seen a pharmacy student before. Anyway, they said, it wrangled on, and the president union said, what do you think we should do? And I said, I think we should open a club for students. And the president of the union said, all right, clever dick, open a club. And I said, fuck you, I will. So I opened a club. No clue whatsoever of what, where, when, or how. I opened a club called Club 66 in January 1966, and that was the end of pharmacy.
And you went to, you had a period of time spent in San Francisco, I believe, around about sort of 67, 68.
A period of time in what?
In the States, in San Francisco.
Yes.
At a time when it was obviously a lot of...
Well, in my last year at university, even though I ended up booking shows for 12 colleges and universities across the South Coast and was running Club 66 one, and then we opened another club as well, and we were bringing, I mean, all this was for the university, so I ended up, it was just bizarre, I ended up being on the finance committee of the university because we're bringing so much money in. So I thought this is an interesting way of life. And then I wanted to stand for president of the union, and I had to get signed off by my professor, who refused point blank and said, you're here to study. And I got even more angry. I said, you know, studying what? Because what happened was the course I wanted to do got stopped. We had to register for an external London University degree, which is the one thing I didn't want to do, which is why I chose the course I did. Anyway, so as a sop, he sent me on an exchange course to America. And I went to America. I have an aunt and uncle who lived in New York. And I was sent to this wonderful university called the University of Toledo in Ohio, which is like being in space, and to study pharmacology, which they had a very good school there, which may well be, but the University of Toledo in Ohio wasn't my idea of fun. So I did a semester there. I left. I went to see my aunt and uncle in New York. I saw an ad in the paper which offered $99, 99 days unlimited travel by Greyhound bus for international students. So I had an international student card. I thought, this sounds amazing. Bought the thing and went from one side of America to the other and saw... I saw places in America then that even today I've never seen since. You know, it was an amazing experience. Ended up in San Francisco, crossing Golden Gate Bridge, heard a rumpus going on, looked down and saw a huge crowd of people underneath the bridge or nearby, checked in at the Y in downtown San Francisco where I was going to stay, and wormed my way back to Golden Gate Park. And there was a concert going on with the Grateful Dead and a band called Quicksilver Messenger Service, which was Stephen Stills' band. And I wormed my way backstage because in America then, if you spoke with a Cockney accent that I have and you start talking to people, they all go, oh, keep talking, we love your accent. Blah, blah, blah. Got backstage, told them I was the biggest promoter in Europe, befriended the Grateful Dead, which lasted over 30 years. In fact, I just saw Warren Haynes last week. He was playing at the Palladium. And the next thing that happened was somebody came up to me and said, don't drink anything that's in a glass. I said, sorry? He said, don't drink anything that's in a glass. So I thought I heard what he said. I picked up a can of Coke that somebody just opened for me, behind the barn, and gave me the Coke. And 3 days later, I woke up, and I was in Peter Fonda's house. I've no idea to this day how I got there, but they spiked my drink. Anyway, it was Haight-Ashbury. It was that period of time in the mid-60s, I maintain, is still the most creative period of our modern times and our lifetime. There was so much change going on. Every single week, a new act would emerge that you'd never heard of before, and suddenly were smashing the walls down everywhere. It was a time of change because it was that period of time when young people demanded a say in society, whereas pre that, it was seen and not heard. It was that period of the Vietnam War, the demonstrations, the student riots in Paris. All this was going on. It was the change in fashion. It was the change in style. It was the change in literature. It was a change in art. And it was certainly the change in music. And I'm so lucky to be grown up in that period because every single week, I was finding a new act that just blew me away from the light when I saw last week. And they were just coming up one after the other. So I count myself lucky. And one thing, listening to that really interesting talk this morning that you started off with, the one thing you have to learn about the entertainment business is there aren't really any rules. And for one thing for sure, it is not a job. There's no clocking on or clocking off. If you want to be in this business, it is your life. It's a lifestyle. It's 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And people ask me, often, what do you have to do to be a promoter? I said, you run a 24-hour wet nappy service, and it's constant. And that's what it is.
So many other things to talk about. I mean, just on the subject of grassroots, because obviously that's where you kind of came from. You had to work from the bottom to the top. you've got a perspective of decades as well. So how do you feel the health of the grassroots industry is, if you like, at the moment, where it comes to new talent coming in, support for new artists, support for people that are running grassroots music venues, and people who are trying to set up new festivals and get concepts off the ground in very difficult circumstances where you've got cost of living crisis, you've got cost of supply chain going crazy, and you've also got dominant players in the market?
I think it's very difficult today. It's really strange. When I started, there were no rules and there weren't many people in it. So it was waking up every day. I teamed up with another ex-student from the college who was, funnily enough, sent down there to learn something about computing when one computer would just about fill this room, and he got bored with it, and he and I set up in business together. He had a flat in Primrose Hill, one bedroom, and we decided to go into business. We had no idea what we were doing. We'd wake up every day, and what do we do now? And it was, you've just got to have the confidence to push yourself forward. And also, there's no word no in our business. You know, if you want to get somewhere, you just can't take no for an answer. You've got to keep going till, you know, you get to where you want to. For reasons that I'm not quite sure, in this wonderful age of technology and this wonderful age of social media and whatever, it's 50 times harder to get a break today than it was when there was nothing. And it's really complicated, it's difficult, it's too diverse, there's too many genres. And in music, it's all over the place. In marketing, it's all over the place. In direction, there isn't any. So consequently, it's much tougher today. And with the big conglomerates controlling the industry, I'm not against them, but it becomes much, much harder for individuals to make their way through, obviously. And when you get down on the floor, there is a huge disparity between the top half a dozen or eight or nine acts that you read about every single day of the week and those people struggling from the floor trying to break through. It's a nightmare. So clubs are struggling, bars are struggling that feature music, small venues are struggling, and acts are struggling because obviously the cycle of, again, when I started in business and as it developed, it was a cycle of recording music, selling records, promoting those records, and then going out on the road. And you had to constantly go out on the road to build up a following. They don't work anymore because, I keep hearing the same thing today with new acts, and acts coming through. Where's my brand? I have to have a brand. I've got to have, you know. And if you don't find an act a brand in 6 months, you're out. You're gone. So it's a completely bizarre business. You know, if you mentioned to any of the acts I grew up with, like, you know, even the Stones at the time or Bruce Springsteen or when he first started or, you know, The Who or Genesis or whatever, that, you know, we're going to look for a brand partnership, they think you're insane. Today, without it, they don't get out of bed. So it is completely different. The rules are different. And I think it's 10 times harder to break through in any direction than it should be. And I think this whole world of technology, which most of us spend our lives trying to catch up on and try to understand, it actually doesn't work because it's either too far ahead of us or we just don't understand it. And so, as I say, it's difficult.
Okay, and I want to talk a bit more about your career because there's so many things we can talk about. But you're, I would say, you know, without doubt, best known outside the music industry for and in it really for Live Aid, which was a momentous, obviously, event, raised millions of pounds. It was watched by something like 1.5 billion people in 60 countries, which I think is the biggest TV audience.
1.6.
1.6. So I mean, you know, the history of it's been talked about a lot. Obviously, you know, Midjour, yourself, and Bob Geldof getting this incredible project off the ground. I'm sure you've got lots of amazing memories of it, but can you give us a couple of moments that I guess have stuck with you from that time?
Well, funnily enough, you can actually go and see it. As of January, there's a musical called Just for One Day that's being produced at the Old Vic, which is the story of Live Aid and Band Aid. It's nothing to do with, we don't own it or anything, but fortunately we negotiated when they wanted the rights. So a percentage of the profits are coming back to the Band Aid Trust, which is still going, still giving out money, doesn't promote itself, doesn't ask for anything, but we still manage to give out between £3 and £5 million a year. And there's still obviously the same issues in the region as there always was when we started. It was an interesting, again, an interesting era. What caught everybody's imagination was the fact, for the first time ever, people were seeing on the 6 o'clock news, well, the discussion point in Europe was about food mountains and butter mountains and fruit mountains and what to do with surplus. We're suddenly looking at pictures of people down the road in Africa who were starving, and there was no equation between the two. And so it was Bob's shock at seeing it and thinking about it and saying, we've got to do something. And so after the record came out and Bob came to see me and said, we've got to do this concert, the reason it took so long, it was such a short time rather, to actually run it, we did it from start to finish in 10 and a half weeks, was because I was absolutely up to my neck. I was putting on Bruce Springsteen at Wembley Stadium. I had to take Wham to China, first Western act ever to go to China, which got suddenly dumped on me. And Roger Waters had left the Pink Floyd and was doing his solo career and was playing in Radio City in New York. And I had all these projects on, and Bob was banging on the door, so we've got to do this concert. So I said, I can't do it till if I get back from China. When I get back from China, we'll have a look at it. So that's why it happened so quickly. But I think it was of its time. Everybody was in shock when they saw those pictures because they'd never seen them before. They didn't understand it. They didn't know anything about it. And even though, you know, I could talk about this for hours and hours and hours, how we put it together and all the rest of it, but the fact is that all the artists that came along, and I sent everybody a note saying, kind of leave your ego at the door. And also, I said, in order to make the show work, because when Bob marched into my office one morning and we became yin and yang, he said, we haven't got enough, Wembley's not big enough, we've got to do it in America as well. So we had to search for a venue in America, and we finally homed in on Philadelphia, which is the home of the Liberty Bell, purely and simply because we couldn't get a venue in New York, we couldn't get a venue in Washington, we couldn't get a venue in Boston, and it had to be on the East Coast because of the time difference when the satellite arrives between 5 hours on the East Coast and 8 hours on the West Coast. That's really how it happened. Most things get waxed lyrical when 100 years later when people talk about it, but the fact of life is it was expediency that made it happen. And so our target was 5 million. That was our target. And we thought if we could make £5 million out of it, it would be fantastic. And of course, we ended up with £143 million. And pushed it.
Yeah, it was an incredible result. It's by far far from the only charitable event that you've worked on. You've worked on all sorts of fundraising events over the years. The Freddie Mercury concert, work for Amnesty, a lot of different events that have raised an awful lot of money. Do you feel that the industry still embraces the opportunity to raise money for good causes as well as it could do? Do you feel that Live Aid really changed the way it kind of viewed that opportunity?
So I was very lucky. I did very well out of our industry, and for me to put something back was easy. And so I've been doing it most of my working life, where it's working with The Who to build homes for battered wives, whether it was for concerts for Campuchia with Paul McCartney, whatever, before and after the whole Live Aid experience. It's a lot harder today. There are artists that still do it. There are, obviously, there's all sorts of fundraisers that go on all over the place. But I think, to some extent, sometimes the attitude has changed a bit, because the same acts seem to pitch up every single time. And the newer acts don't get it. And unfortunately, a lot of the new acts don't want to know about it. So it becomes a lot narrower in the pathway. I mean, when you think, I started the Teenage Cancer Trust concerts. I did 7 years of it before I decided that was enough, and now SJM does it. And it's very successful, but very succinct and very easy to understand. Kids who suffer from cancer, unless they're in a specialised ward, are stuck in with either babies or geriatrics. They don't have any space for themselves. And teenagers going through, you know, through puberty, their change of life and whatever, the whole idea of Teenage Cancer Trust is to find money to build specific wards for kids with cancer. It's so easy to understand, and that's why it works so well. So when you've got a simple cause, people get it. I'm currently working with a group of five young people, helping them through, because they want to do something about the environment. And there's a lot of plans afoot to do something very specific. But it will involve a big concert, I think. But it's not just about that, because, as I keep saying to everybody, with these cause events, the event itself is the easy bit. What it is, it's the run-up to the event, and then what happens thereafter. Because everybody wants to know, where does the money go, what am I doing it for, and why? And you have to show results. That's really, really important if you're doing it in that world. And it will continue. And God bless all the artist community for coming to the table and constantly doing things. But it is definitely a lot harder.
You've, to be honest, you know, promoted a lot of enviable shows, like, from my perspective anyway, you know, the reunion of Led Zeppelin, obviously, at the O2, which is, you know, amazing. You've been involved with so many bands at huge, you know, huge international operators. It's a difficult question to answer, but you promoted not only concerts, obviously, you've got done shows of all kind of different genres. What are you most at home with? What do you find most rewarding in terms of the nature or style of a performance?
I look upon entertainment with a big E, and I look for things that entertain, where performances and artists and whatever could cross over that end of the stage and entice people and for people to enjoy. So I may be unique actually now, but I sit just as happily in the classical world as I do in the pop and rock world. So I'm always, and my office has become an ideas factory. So every day of the week, people are throwing ideas at me, and I pick them up and look at them and try and see what I think could entertain people. Currently, I'm quite deeply involved in the immersive world, and I think that entertainment is entertainment. So when I got a phone call from a friend of mine in LA saying, "You've got to come over to LA. Can you come over this weekend?" And I said, "It's like Tuesday. Why?" And they said, "You've got to come and see this circus." And I just said, "Very funny." And they said, "No, seriously, you've got to come to LA and see this circus." I said, "Why on earth do I want to go to America to see a circus? We've got dozens of them here." And he said, "But it's different." I said, "What do you mean different?" He said, "I'm telling you, get on a plane, come and see it." Off I went. And the circus was on the end of Santa Monica Pier, and it was called Cirque du Soleil. And I started asking a few people, and they said, "Oh, yeah, it's incredible." And I went to see it, and just completely blew me away. It then took me a year to persuade them to come over to Europe. I then thought I'd buy the Roundhouse, because that'd be the perfect place to put them in. I couldn't buy the Roundhouse because it had been condemned because it was full of asbestos. And then I couldn't have a venue. And they said, "Well, we tour in a tent." And they said, we've got a slot for you. And I said, "Great." And they said January. I said, people don't do tents in London in January. Thank you very much. I then thought, where the hell do I go? And then I honed in and said, it's got to be the Royal Albert Hall. Well, I went to the Royal Albert Hall and they said, you can't have a circus. We're not allowed to. It's in our constitution. No kids under five, no circuses. Thank you. And I went to search and say, so you've got to play the Royal Albert Hall. Said, no, we only do the tent. We don't play anywhere indoors. So it took me another year to persuade both the Royal Albert Hall and Cirque du Soleil that it was a great place. It's their most profitable venue on the whole of their tour anywhere in the world. And it's been running consistently for, I think it's 32 years now, yeah. Every January. So if you see something, which I do, in my mind, I can see something. I can see something, whether it's an artist, whether it's a show, whether it's bringing, you know, over the Crazy Horse Saloon from Paris or something crazy like that. Currently working on an environmental immersive show called Sensory Odyssey that we persuaded the Natural History Museum to give us a slot between two exhibitions for 3 months. It stayed there for 9 months, and the only reason we had to come out was because they were about to be sued by the exhibition that should have gone in there 6 months previous. Again, same experience in Singapore. We just finished there 3 months longer than we were supposed to be there. And things of that nature. And other active, immersive type shows, which I think are the future. Because I think young people today don't want to sit in a passive room watching a play. They want to be part of it. They want to experience it. They want to live with it. And that's why the live industry is so strong and will always be so strong, because you cannot beat the live experience.
Okay, what's your view on maybe the live experience being shut off to some people, in the sense that ticket prices are extremely high in some areas for some shows? You've got the likes of Viagogo, you know, inflating second. You know, you've got this whole secondary ticketing market. It's different in the UK to the States. It's different in different countries and different parts of the world. But essentially, ticket pricing is going through the roof, and we're in a period of time where obviously there's a cost of living crisis. So if we can't get young people through the door and in to see shows, they can't afford it. That's going to impact the future. If artists can't afford to go on tour because it's too expensive for them to get on tour, it's going to impact the future. What are you positive about the future? Or do you feel that we're in a difficult period at the moment with that whole climate, if you like, of unaffordability of tickets to certain shows?
The world of music is like fashion and style. It goes in a cycle. I think we're in a very strange time at this moment. We home in on Beyonce, Taylor Swift, Bruce Springsteen, whatever. We don't think about new acts coming up. And as I said earlier, there is a total disparity between what you have to pay to go and see your hero, if you want to see Taylor Swift or Bruce Springsteen or whatever, to what you can charge if you're a new burgeoning act trying to break through. And I think it's wrong. I've spent most of my life fighting touts in one way, shape or other. I believe that we as promoters have a duty of care, that if we put the price of the ticket is 25 quid, and obviously there is a cost to pay for convenience, i.e. to buy it online, which should be regularised, in my opinion, at 10%, that's what you should pay. I'm 150 million times against this secondary ticket market, the way tickets sold in America, the way tickets are sold here. I think it's a disgrace. I think our industry should be totally ashamed of itself for the way it allows these practices to happen. Because if you're ripping somebody off at the top end who have to go and see or want to go and see their heroes, how on earth do you have money in your pocket to go and try and see an act, to see an act as a tryout at the other end? You just don't bother. So we're creating this massive void, and I think it's totally wrong.
Absolutely. can you just talk a little bit about what you have? Obviously, you've got the musical next year, which is great to see. Which is obviously not your production necessarily, but obviously you're involved in it, and you've been, you know, you approved it, and it's raising money, which is fantastic. What's in the pipeline at the moment? What are you sort of focused on?
I still promote concerts. I don't do that many because I've given. I've been on the road so many times. I'm kind of cooling down a bit. I again, during COVID, when life stopped, most of the production people who work on shows, concerts, festivals, and whatever are freelance. And suddenly, their whole life was cut off. So I put a group of them together and I said, look, why don't we form a company which you're all a share of, because none of you got a pension plan, none of you got a future. When there's work, that's great, but now we're living in a world when there's no work, so what the hell are you going to do now? Your life is cut off. Let's put it together, and as work comes in, each of you can earn off each other. So I set up a company called Invisible, and Invisible was a white label production company. And I put five of the top production guys in the world together in this business. And the idea is, and what we do is, we then bring on board young people, which we bring through and train. And also, we go around producing shows for other people. It saves those people hiring full-time staff. They get the best of the best around the world. And we work around the world. We're in from, you know, from Bali to Peru at any time of the day or night. And we produce a lot of shows, but we do it for other people. And it's called Invisible for that very reason, because as far as we're concerned, we're whoever we are, they are when they want us to be. And they don't know who we are. We don't promote ourselves as an entity. So we're doing a lot of that work. I'm also, as I say, working on a whole way of presenting the best of immersive type shows and looking for a solution to do that and find venues, which is always very difficult. And that keeps me busy and helping these guys with environmental shows. So my life never stops.
great. Okay. And in terms of how, obviously, we, you know, aside from the ticketing aspect, I mean, you've got that brilliant perspective of being able to look back over decades from the 60s onwards in terms of the way that the live music industry has evolved. How healthier state would you say it's in now? And obviously, you know, in some ways it's become much more professional. You've got amazing venues that have been built over the years. You've got you've got this industry coming together to really try and work effectively to minimize its environmental impact. Money's being pushed back into society in certain areas properly, and we're trying to help new people through into the industry. Do you feel positive about where we are right now and where we're going?
Yeah, on that side of things, of course, things have changed in the main for the better across the board. As you heard earlier, there's a lot more opportunities for young people to get in from all different types of backgrounds. There are training courses which you can go on to learn. Hopefully more companies are taking on trainees and teaching them through. I mean, at the end of the day, the best training is to learn by example and learn by mistakes, which is what I did. But the most important thing, if you want to be in this industry, and I tell people this all the time, one, do your research. Which part of the industry you're interested in? I chair the Rock and Roll Museum, which is in Liverpool, which people in London don't really seem to know about, but it's called the British Music Experience. And we do classes every single day, and every week we'll take a facet of the industry, whether it's PR, whether it's A&R, whether it's production, whether it's being a tour photographer or whatever or anything. And we do talks and lectures on that to help to tell people and explain to them how that works. We're based in Liverpool. We're in the Cunard building, which is one of the three graces. And we have people, we have classes and schools coming every single day of the week. And we tell the story of music in Britain from 1946 to actually today and tomorrow. So it's another way of finding out and learning about your history. But you need to do that research. What part of the industry am I interested in? And then you've got to have the confidence in yourself to really keep pushing till you get to where you want to get to, because no one's going to push for you. So as a result of that, there are so many more opportunities coming up, and there's some really good things happening. There is a whole movement to do something about the environment and climate change in the industry. There's some amazing new, you know, people coming into the promoting world. As again, as you heard on the last talk, there are thousands of festivals going on, so there's tons of opportunities there. It may be there's too much. My moan and groan about the disparity between the top end and the bottom end doesn't change. My problem with the way ticketing is distributed will continue until eventually. And I can't tell you how many secretaries of state I've been to see to explain to them how our business works, and can you please put some legislation in to stop the resale of ticketing? And they all I get is, well, how do I get my Wimbledon tickets? I could tell, I mean, one after the other. They just don't understand it, or they don't want to understand it. In America, it's different pressure because the lobbying groups that go to senators and congressmen who are constantly lobbying for about it. If you can believe it, there are artists who are like-minded to the way I think, where I go around from venue to venue and literally impose rules. I'm about to do it at the Royal Albert Hall, for example, on a particular act. We will not allow tickets to be sold at more than the face value plus the box office commission. And anybody that does that, we will check them on the door and we'll cancel those tickets. There are at least 10 states in America where it is illegal to stop this practice. It's illegal to stop people from making a profit out of reselling a ticket. Go figure that one out.
It's absolutely baffling. Well, fantastic stuff. Thank you very much, Harvey. And we've got time for some questions from the audience. I will have to have that light dim so I can see people, please. Oh, great. Okay. Right in the front here.
Hello, Harvey.
There we go.
Graham Brown here. We've done many shows together over the years. I've been in many rooms together. But interested to ask you a question. By the way, I was out with Mick Warwood last week. So, yeah, it was an interesting old catch-up. He had some good stories. Question. If you were told you could bring one band back and do one last show from all of your years, who would the band be and why?
Good question.
That's a tough one. I think, strangely enough, the one artist that I spent a huge amount of time with and worked with for over 26 years, who is the greatest rock and roll star of all time, was Pavarotti. And he's a classical performer. But I'd never heard a voice like that until I worked with him. And we played in countries and cities that I had to look up on the map to see where we'd get 30,000 people showing up to hear him. It was quite extraordinary. And he would sit just as happily with, you know, Kiri Takano or James or Joan Sutherland in the Royal Opera House as he would be with Elton John or Bono from U2 doing a concert, or even Eric Clapton. The most extraordinary man I'd ever met, ever dealt with. I loved him. And if I had my chance to do one more concert, it would absolutely be with him. Who else could perform in Hyde Park to 150,000 people in the pissing rain with an orchestra and continue singing and wow the audience?
Brilliant. Lovely stuff. Anyone else? Again, I can't actually... Oh, there we go. Lovely. Okay, last opportunity. Anyone else? And down the front again. Thank you very much.
Hi, Harvey. So obviously we're talking a lot about the disparity between kind of the high-end, the kind of Taylor Swift's and Beyonce's and the smaller scale concerts. I was wondering what you think we can do as an industry to encourage kind of audiences to take a risk and kind of potentially spend money on those smaller scale gigs that they may kind of be a bit apprehensive to go to.
It's not easy. It's a combination of the owners of the smaller venues and the smaller promoters to find bands that or artists that they know are winners and constantly giving them opportunity to perform so they build up the audience. All the big acts, all the dinosaur acts that you see today and, you know, that are constantly on the road and whatever is because they were constantly on the road at the beginning. So the first thing is, you have to, as a venue owner, if you find an act that you really like and the audience like, you've got to keep putting them on so they can build an audience up. That's very important. You've got to take risks. And from the public, they've got to get to know that when you as the venue owner or the promoter say, come and see this band, it's going to be a winner. I know, and I'm lucky enough, I could put Turk Thrust and the Y-Fronts on at the Royal Albert Hall, and I know I'll sell 25% of the tickets because I say so, because people have followed me for years and years and years. And I think it's really important that you give the confidence, one, to the artist, and B, to the audience, that you're not going to deliver rubbish. And so if you see talent that is really good that's coming up, you've got to push that talent through, and it's got to work at both ends. And obviously, it's got to be at a price that everyone can afford because they're taking a risk. They're taking a, when they go and see their heroes, they know exactly what they're getting. When they're going to see an unknown band, they've got no idea what they're getting. So they need to know when they get there that they're going to be wowed. And that's probably the best advice I can give.
Lovely stuff. Well, thank you very much, Harvey.
Pleasure.
Great to chat.
Thank you.
Thank you.